Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to the Lord's house on this Sunday morning. There are a couple of announcements that I'd like to make at this time. One is the public service announcement. We finally have a clear idea about the July 2nd joint community service. And though I need to have the session come up after worship just to say yes, the joint service will be here instead of the Methodist church because Pamela will be playing, and it'll be at 10:30 a.m. with Pastor Mike delivering the message. The Bible studies are running their normal schedule, so Tuesday we have it, Wednesday we don't. But we will be having worship at Sunrise Terrace in the afternoon, and I invite you to come to that if you would like. There's another extra insert in your bulletin, I Am the Vine, that's going to be used as a prelude. And so that's so that you can listen to the words or read the word along with the words as you go, and you can understand and appreciate the song, which is very beautiful. So again, I would like the members of the session that are here, and there's looks like 4 out of 5, to please come up after the worship service. Are there any other announcements to make at this time? Well, if not, then let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we listen to I Am the Vine. Please stand and read responsively the call to worship as it is written in your bulletins. As we come together in worship,
we give thanks for this day that you have made.
As we share in scripture and silence, song and stillness, prayer and preaching,
be present with us wherever we find ourselves.
Receive all we offer.
Renew all that we are.
Unite us in this time of sharing,
that we might travel on with you.
Please remain standing as we sing our opening hymn, number 581. Brethren, we have been to worship.
Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Brethren, see poor sinners round you slumbering on the brink of woe. Death is coming, hell is moving, can you bear to let them go? See our fathers and our mothers and our children sinking down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Sisters, will you join and help us? Moses' sister aided him. Will you help the trembling mourners who are struggling hard with sin? Tell them all about the Savior. Tell them that he will be found. Sisters, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Let us love our God supremely. Let us love each other too. Let us love and pray for sinners till our makes all things new. Then he'll call us home to heaven. At his table we'll sit down. Christ will gird himself and serve us with sweet manna all around.
You may be seated. Please join me responsively in reading number 63, Father's Day, in your little brown responsive reading book, which is taken from Luke 15 and Ephesians 6. And now I gotta focus. Bifocals are fun. When the younger told his father, "I want my share of your estate now instead of waiting until you die," his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. I told you. Bifocals. I should have read the first line and I read the... Anyway, let me try. We got to the second line. A few days later, the younger son packed all his belongings and took a trip to a distant land, and there wasted all his money on parties and prostitutes.
About the time his money was gone, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve.
He persuaded a local farmer to hire him to feed his pigs.
The boy became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the swine looked good to him. And no one gave him anything.
When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "At home, even the hired men have food enough and to spare, and here I am, dying of hunger.
I will go home to my father and say, 'Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and am no longer worthy of being called your son.' Please take me on as a hired man.
So he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long distance away, his father saw him coming and was filled with loving pity and ran and embraced him and kissed him.
His son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and you, and am not worthy of being called your son.
But his father said to the slaves, Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him, and a jeweled ring for his finger, and shoes.
And kill the fattened calf.
We must celebrate the feast, for the son of mine was dead, and he has returned to life. He was lost and is found.
Children, obey your parents. This is the right thing to do because God has placed them in authority over you.
Honor your father and mother.
This is the first of God's Ten Commandments that ends with a promise.
And this is the promise, that if you honor your father and mother, yours will be a long life full of blessings.
For those of you who never see and get to know, this is the size print I'm used to reading. Really blew that one. Anyway, the proof of God's love is this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Assured already of God's grace and forgiveness, let us confess our sin together using the unison prayer of confession printed in your bulletin, followed by a time of silent reflection on God's goodness. Let us pray. In your faithfulness, God of love and hope, hear our confession and pray. We confess the words spoken and things done which have harmed us and hurt others this week. Hasty words, perhaps, unkind thoughts, acts of frustration. We confess words never spoken and things undone which have laid guilt upon us and left possibility incomplete. Words of kindness or challenge left unsaid. Acts of generosity thought about but never acted upon. We look beyond ourselves and confess that your good creation and your beautiful human family all too often are broken by sin and racked by evil.
Lord, forgive us.
Forgive the things we know and the things we haven't noticed. Lift us from the guilt we carry. Set us free to serve you with joy and passion. Renew, restore, begin again your good news within us. Amen. Hear the good news. God's steadfast love endures forever, and God's faithfulness is promised to all generations. We are justified by faith, forgiven and freed, and at peace with God and each other through Jesus Christ. Amen. Please join me in the unison prayer for illumination. God of wisdom, speak again your liberating word to us today. By the power of your Holy Spirit poured into our hearts, make us ready and willing to respond to your call to us today. Amen. Our reading today is from Romans chapter 11, verses 11 through 24, and can be found on page 1762 in your pew Bible. We don't like it when we see others get something better than us, when it doesn't seem to us that they deserve it. Even if they do deserve it, we may not be very happy about it. We are generally not bothered when we are the ones getting something better, because we like to think that we do deserve it.
Paul's discussion of Jews and Gentiles in Romans 11 may stir up uncomfortable feelings. Many of us would rather get away from talking about Jew versus Gentile and just say that God loves everyone. But while we believe that we are all equal before God, both Scripture and experience tell us that God does use different people in different ways. Instead of comparing ourselves with other people, we need to heed Paul's reminder to focus on God's kindness and severity, to remember that our sin deserves God's judgment, and to be grateful for his grace in giving us salvation through Jesus Christ. Romans 11, 11 through 24. Again, I ask, did they stumble so as to fall beyond recovery? Not at all. Rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. But if their transgression means riches for the world, and their loss means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their fullness bring? I am talking to you, Gentiles. Inasmuch as I am the apostle to the Gentiles, I make much of my ministry in the hope that I may somehow arouse my own people to envy and save some of them. For if their rejection is the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? If part of the dough offered as first fruits is holy, then the whole batch is holy. If the root is holy, so are the branches. If some of the branches have been broken off, and you, though a wild olive shoot, have been grafted in among the others and now shoot in the nourishing sap from the olive root, do not boast over these branches. If you do, consider this. You do not support the root, but the root supports you. You will say then, branches are broken off so that I could be grafted in. Granted, but they were broken off because of unbelief, and you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but be afraid. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. Consider therefore the kindness and sternness of God, sternness to those who fell and kindness to you, provided that you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you also will be cut off. And if they do not persist in unbelief, they will be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. After all, if you are cut out of an olive tree that is wild by nature, and contrary to nature were grafted onto a cultivated olive tree, how much more readily will these natural branches be grafted onto their own olive tree? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Chapter 11 has been addressing Israel's place in salvation history. And despite all of Israel's faults, she's never been less than God's chosen means of bringing blessing to the world. And everything else that he has chosen to do must be seen in this context. Speaking to the Gentiles, of course, he started chapter 11 by saying, did God reject his people? And then he says, no, that the Jews are still God's people. And then he asks a second question in verse 11. Did they stumble so as to fall beyond recovery? That is, are they beyond saving? And again, he says, not at all. Rather, we as Gentiles had the opportunity for salvation because of their transgression, and he gave us salvation to make the Israelites jealous. But if they get saved, how much better is it than it is right now? He hopes through his own ministry to make the point about to Israel about salvation and it coming to the Gentiles. And then he begins to use an analogy with grafting. And I'm no master gardener, nor am I a farmer, but I have seen trees that have borne multiple types of fruit. My parents had a lemon tree in their Arizona home, but it also gave some other kind of fruit, which I can't remember, citrus fruit. And they did, that was done by a previous owner, grafting that branch, that fruit tree, onto the lemon tree. And I know that pears and apples, for instance, have been put on same trees, etc. It's a practice in order to help things flourish. Now, olives and olive trees are integral to Palestine and the Jerusalem. And Jesus himself, you know, he went on the Mount of Olives. Can you guess what was on that mount? Olive trees. Picking olives for pressing and making olive oil is still actually a major export from Israel. But as I studied this week, I found some interesting things about olive trees. Perhaps not as strange as you might think. Wild olive trees do not produce what we would call good fruit. I mean, the fruit might be edible, but it's small, it's hard, it's not as much there. The cultivated olive trees provide much larger and flavorful fruit. But wild olive trees are very hardy. It's said that they can live between at least 1,000 years, and some of the root systems have even been said to be about 2,000 years old there. So there was a tour, I read a blog about it, where the guide said that some of the olive trees that they saw on the Mount of Olives might have been there since Jesus was there. However, wild olive trees, whether due to weather or other things, tend to get very twisted and crooked. And it affects how their fruit comes out. The roots are strong, but the branches are brittle. And so the practice was in Palestine to take cultivated olive branches and graft them onto the wild olive branches, olive trees. That way they were able to take advantage of the extensive root systems of the wild olive trees while still producing the kind of fruit that they wanted. Now Paul is using this analogy for the people he is writing to. He notes that the olive tree has long been a symbol of Israel and the vine, and the cultivated olive tree represents here the people of God, whose root is the patriarchs and whose stern stem represents the continuity of the people of God through the centuries. The Jews and Gentiles are both considered branches. Now, some of them have been broken off. And Paul says that stands for the unbelieving Jews who have been discarded. And some wild olive branches or Gentile believers have been grafted in among the others, or the believing Jewish remnant. But we all now share in the nourishing sap of the olive root. And so this connection to God's tree can bring great blessing. But the blessings that salvation provides are not a ground for boasting, but rather should cause thanksgiving and caution. And again, Paul says fairly frequently that there's no reason to boast about salvation in terms of I'm saved, because you didn't do anything to earn it. So in the following verses, he gives three cautions. First, he says to be cautious of conceit. Then he says to be cautious of complacency. And then he says to be cautious with God's goodness. Now, this isn't something, as the liturgist noted, that we seem to want to hear. And it has some pretty harsh things to say to Gentiles and some things that may be hard to hear about God, however true they are. So, if we have been grafted into the tree, then we need to be careful not to think that we're the primary in the tree, especially since we're wild. If a wild branch is cultivated into a cultivated one, it'll grow just as much as the cultivated one will grow in the wild one, as long as it's taken care of. And we are being grafted, unlike the way they did it, grafting cultivated branches into the wild trees. It's the opposite with God. Us wild branches have been grafted into a cultivated tree, if you will. We, and he says in Romans 11, 24, that this is contrary to nature. And so, we must not look down upon Israel or the Jews. Don't be arrogant toward the branches. But if you're arrogant, remember that it is not you who supports the root, but the root that supports you. To be blessed by God and His grace is no reason to boast. We Gentiles are linked to Abraham, who's the father of all believe, but we're linked by fruit and by being grafted onto the vine or onto the tree. And we partake of its goodness solely by God's grace. And I think that it's interesting that God did not cut down salvation's tree and plant a new one. His choice was rather to graft other branches into his true and eternal roots. Even in the Old Testament, it talks about a new shoot coming out of the stump of Jesse. The church did not replace the synagogue, and the Christians did not replace the Jewish people. And it's important for us to understand that because, frankly, through the history of the church, even into modern day, there are those that believe that we have, that the Jews are no longer God's people, that God has basically tossed them under the bus, and we don't have to take special care about them. And yet, Paul says we do. Because an attack on Israel means an attack on the root and revelation of God. He has but one tree, indicating that there is but one people of God. And we have the fortune of being a part of that by God's grace. So we should never be arrogant or conceited about the fact that we are saved and many and most of the Jews are not. And we should be cautious about complacency. He says that the Jews, that is their branches, were broken off for unbelief. But you stand by your faith, do not be conceited, but fear. Any Gentile that has been grafted in stands right before God by faith in Jesus Christ. But you need to have a proper fear of God. God will remove you if you persist in unbelief. Frankly, and this is just my take on it, and I may have said this last week, but I think that the ultimate sin, the sin that can't be forgiven that Jesus spoke of, is the sin of, when it talks about blaspheming against the Holy Spirit, is the sin of refusing the grace of God and salvation. The Spirit has convicted you of sin. The Spirit has opened your eyes. And according to Hebrews, many of them have even come to the church. They've turned to Christ, but then they turn away. And they give it up. And they say, not a Christian anymore, and I refuse to believe in that kind of salvation. And you see it today. Seems like there's been a whole slew of musicians and writers and people that have been Christians for a long time even, who suddenly decide that they have this epiphany and they cannot believe in evangelical Christianity anymore. And some of them just flat out don't believe in Christ. And that makes a huge impact on the Christian community and the next generation. Let's face it. Whether we like it or not, they have influence. They have followers. And they have people who have even been brought to Christ by them. And now, the one who brought them to Christ turns away. When the natural branches refuse to believe, God reserved the right to remove them, and He will not hesitate to do the same with the wild branches. There is no room for unbelief or complacency, only humble trust. It is the continuance in belief that is the truest evidence of genuine faith. John Calvin in his Tulip talked about the perseverance of the saints. The saints are the ones who persevere in their faith throughout their life and their trials. He even spoke of that in the invisible church and said that in every church there are those that are saved and those that think they're saved, but they're not. Jesus referred to it when he talked about separating the sheep from the goats. And those who are true to their faith will be faithful through their whole life and trusting God. And just because you've been chosen by God to receive mercy doesn't mean you're worthy of it. In fact, it's the opposite. The experience of grace assumes the need for grace. There would be no mercy without the presence of sin. Remember, grace is getting something that you don't deserve as a gift. Mercy is not getting something you do deserve as a gift. So we never have reason to be either proud or complacent. We should never be saying, well, I'm good. I've had my conversion. I've accepted Jesus Christ as Savior. No worries. I got my ticket into heaven. And then just go on and lead life the way you feel like. That's being complacent. Being complacent can also be those that say, well, I come to church every Sunday. I do work for the church. And yeah, I had this area over here, but I'm a good person. My good outweighs my bad, so I'm okay. That's not the way God works. You're not okay, and you need to work on those parts of your life that are still not under the rule of God. We need to be cautious with God's goodness and understand His goodness and His sternness. You know, a lot of people these days don't like to think about God as a judge. And yet, all through Scripture it talks about that. As a king, as the ruler of the universe, God judges. In Romans 5, we find out that there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus, but that's condemnation, not judgment. And in verse 22, it references this kindness and sternness as aspects of God's nature. Behold the kindness and severity of God to those who fell, severity. But to you, God's kindness, if you continue in His kindness, otherwise you also will be cut off. Those in the present who have identified with the saving gospel must continue in His kindness, or they too will be judged severely like those in the past who were near the blessing and then fell. True saving faith is shown by its continuity. James, of course, had that famous saying about faith without works is dead. You say, look at my faith, or I say, look at my works that show my faith. Steadfastness is a proof of the reality of faith and a byproduct of salvation, not a means to it. But we must always remember that God is fair and just. And simply because we have been grafted in doesn't mean that we can't face the same consequences. Now, I'm not trying to give some scary hellfire kind of sermon here, or depressing one. But the fact is, we need to remain humble. God loves a servant's heart. We need to remain aware of God's grace at all times. And we need to never, ever look down on others simply because of their lack of faith. Rather, we should grieve for them and pray for them and encourage them in the ways of Christ. May you be the kind of witness that leads to good fruit that comes from being grafted onto the true vine. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you would turn in your hymnals to number 335, we'll sing In Christ There Is No East or West.
is surely kin to me. In Christ am meet both east and west, in him meet south or north. All Christly souls are one in him throughout the whole wide earth.
That fellowship truly does extend throughout the world, as does the commission to share the gospel. God has blessed us in many ways, given us resources, time, talents, treasure. We need to take time always to give thanks to God for that. But then also think about how we might give back to his work, be faithful in his service and witness to who he is. Let's do that as we hear "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." Join me in our unison prayer of dedication. Liberating God, use these gifts to transform the world, to bring about your justice, peace, and reconciliation for all creation. Transform us as we offer them to be partners and co-creators of your beloved kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Missed it by that much. One of the ways in which we show our love and appreciation for God's people is as we pray for and with each other. There are joys and concerns that are printed in your bulletin on the back. There's a prayer list. I ask you to pray for those people by name throughout the week. Let's come before God in prayer. God, Heavenly Father, we do give you thanks and praise. You are an awesome God. You are an awesome Father. Lord, you always provide for us. You give us what we need, even if we don't know it. You give us what we need, even if we may not like it sometimes. You're always looking out for us and giving the best for us. And we take this moment to thank you. Would that all of us who are fathers could be as consistent and faithful as you. Lord, you know us better than we know ourselves. You know everything. And because of that, when we turned away in sin, you made a way for us to come back to you. You made a way for us to be reconciled to you. You made a way for us to be grafted onto the tree or the vine, to be adopted as your children and part of your people. There can be no greater gift than that. And we take this moment to give you thanks and praise that Jesus came and lived among us and suffered and died to cleanse us of our sins. But that wasn't the end. That he was raised again, that we might have new life in him, that we might be new creatures. And then the Spirit was sent that we might be empowered to live lives that witness to you. Lord, we give you thanks for the ability to worship here and that it was meaningful. I pray that people are touched each and every week by your Spirit. We give you thanks for healing. There's few things better to hear for most people than the cancer free, or cancer is fully in remission. Lord, we give you thanks and praise for that miracle, whether it be ordinary or supernatural. And for those whom you heal in a different way, by calling them home. Lord, we give prayers of concern for their family, those that are left behind. May they remember your promise of eternal life. May they remember they shall see loved ones again. And may they know that peace that passes all understanding and only comes from you. Jesus, Prince of Peace, come back soon. Bring your peace to the entire world as every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord to the glory of God the Father. Come back and make things right in the world so there will be no more cancer, no more sickness, no more death, no more tears of sorrow. Oh, what a wonderful thing to imagine. And Holy Spirit, until that day, give us wisdom to know what to say and when to say it. Give us courage to say it. And to love as you have loved. And give us that perseverance of the saints. As we show our salvation and our justification and our faithfulness to you, not just by what we say, but by what we do. And because of that, Holy Spirit, be poured out on this church. Keep it from evil, and may it be a true light in the darkness of this world. May we who are here be beacons of joy and of hope that lead others to know your salvation through Jesus Christ. And Lord, may all that we do and all that we say be forever to your praise and your glory. For we ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the same who taught his disciples when praying to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you would stand as you're able and join me in singing number 316, The Church's One Foundation. For from this place, recharged and renewed, ready to serve the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, sharing the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ and the opportunity for new life. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.